everybody, what's going on? My name is Mark Walters, I'm the programming manager here at Dallas Comic Con FanDays. Welcome to the show, I hope you guys are having a great time. Everybody having fun so far? Well, it's about to get even more fun. So, to my left, who is currently posing for a photo over there, Devin is going to be your moderator. Devin, of course, writes for BigFanboy.com. You've seen him here at all the shows. He is the man that I go to when I'm not available. And he's also our resident Buffy expert. And you've actually done one with James before, right?
This is my third go-round with
Mr. Marsters. Third go-round. Third time's a charm. So everybody, first of all, thank you, Devin. Devin, anything you want to say to the folks before we get going?
We do have a few house rules real quick, ladies and gentlemen. Really quick, please don't ask for any of the following, because we do have two mics available on either side, so we will be going to... I've asked him everything. I don't even know what to ask him anymore. So we do want your questions, we want your involvement, and please do not ask any of the guests for selfies, hugs, Kickstarter money, shout-outs to your Twitter page or anything. And as far as the rest of that goes, that's just common courtesy, but mostly because we have phenomenal photos set up downstairs in the third floor with epic photos, and that's the photo you want, because you'll be holding your camera, it'll be really blurry, and it just won't be bad. Also, if you are videoing this panel or any of the other panels over the course of the weekend, please be considerate of the people behind you. Don't block their view, because you really don't want the view of... You don't want to look at this as you're, you know, watching a Q&A, and you don't want anybody else to have to do that either. So please be considerate of your seatmates. That's the house rules.
Let's not waste any more time. Ladies and gentlemen, James Marsters!
Once again, welcome back to Dallas. It's always a gas to have you here, and sincerely, I've been trying for the last 8 hours to find an acoustic guitar, because the one thing that everybody was telling me from our last visit together was, can you please get James to sing again? Just have him sing some more, but I'll quash that.
T for Texas, T for Tennessee, T for Texas, T for Tennessee. T for Delma, the guy who made a wreck out of me.
There you go. That's it. I figured we should do an open mic night, but you know, I couldn't find a guitar.
Can I just something before we start?
Please.
Okay, I'm looking for dry rub barbecue because I'm on a special diet where you can't have carbohydrates. So I can't have like a normal barbecue because I get a little sauce on and stuff. So if anyone knows about a really good dry rub close to here that would deliver,
let me know. You had it until you said deliver, because I was gonna send you to Hard A in Coppell, which is actually not very far. Hard A, yes. Yeah.
I'm sorry, but I've got 4 hours of sleep, so once we're done here, I'm in a pillow.
I agree. Well, then you wouldn't be able to eat.
No,
would it rip? That sounds like an assassination plot. That doesn't even sound like a good dinner.
If you don't do carbohydrates and only sugar, you can get away with all the fat you want. So that just ribs all night.
Sure. Well, a dry rub though, I mean, there'll be a little bit of sugar in the mix. Yeah, just a little bit. I'm giving you my secret, man. This is important life knowledge.
Sure that. all right. Now over to you. And your agenda.
We do, like I said, we do have two mic stands up here. If you do want to hop up, ask some questions, we definitely want your input on this. I'm a little curious with, you've had an interesting career path. Number one, it's shocking to a lot of people who have not heard you speak before that you're not speaking in a dialect that sounds just south of Johnny Rotten. So, is there one thing where people meet you for the first time that you find funny about? It's like it's funny that they have this reaction and just cracks you up every time.
The problem is, actually I'm from Georgia, which, not Georgia from around here, but Georgia from near Russia, anyway. But there's not a lot of work for people, you know, from my country, so I have to pretend that I'm from California. And I get roll from England, so I have to learn this one as well. But it's a big problem.
Especially now the 24 is out of production. There is one line. Why did we not get you on an episode of 24? Just as like somebody, Jack Bauer is like pointing a gun at your face the entire time. How did that not happen?
I don't know, man. Ask me.
We're gonna start over here.
There was this French product that was plant-based that I really thought was the only thing that would control my hair, right? I was so wrong. Like any clear mucus-like substance that you can buy from the, you know, Rite Aid would work just as well. But I made them pay like $50 a tube. I don't even remember the name of it. But it was water-soluble. So, like that. So yeah, just one quick second.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But I guess the other half of the question is, how long have you had your...
Two would work.
No, well, yeah, but... How did that, man? How long did it take your hair to recover from all of those years of just bleaching ever-loving, holy heck, that's the real...
It wasn't, you know, the hair was fine. It was just like, I'm here. But the scalp took a long time to heal, because it says right on the bottle, only do this every 6 weeks. If you do it more than that, you get cancer, your hair will fall out, all this bad stuff will happen. I know. So,
GLHA.
No, I lucked out. I think I dodged a bullet on that. I went on the Ryan Seacrest show. It was a talk show way back then. And I had them just shave my head on live television. For charity. And so that damaged hair went off, got sold for charity, and I just got rid of it. Yeah.
Right over here. You're good. It's on.
Sorry.
There we go.
What was it like for having Chris Brown Carpenter as your wife in Supernatural?
Damn, it's hot.
I had such a good time shooting with Charisma, man. My big takeaway from doing Supernatural. There's two takeaways. One, Jared Jensen are awesome guys. Absolutely humble and unaffected by the poison that is fame. And Charisma is actually a real sweetheart. And I had no idea that Charisma was a sweetheart because she's a really good actor, and I really thought that she was like her character on Buffy, and I had no, I was like, I'm not talking to her, no way. And I didn't, I avoided her the whole time. Plus, like, whenever she was in a scene with me, her character was always running away from me, so, like, our chairs were always on the opposite side of a very large set, so that we didn't really have a good reason to talk, but for that, we were backstage, you know, the whole time. And we just talked about our kids and the world and everything. And she's really cool. So yeah, I had a great time.
Back over here.
How you doing?
Hey, I'm doing great, man.
Awesome and Buffy, by the way.
Thank you.
And this is why I'm asking you this, because you're an awesome actor, did a good job. Want to see the big screen, and Marvel's taking over. If you were in a Marvel movie that came to you, who would you want to be? What character? What a villain? What a superhero?
Oh, man, you know, okay, John Lennon said that life is what happens while you're busy making other plans, right? So whatever I choose, whatever plan I make, is something else is gonna really happen, actually. And I find that I have a much more interesting career if I just take what comes, kind of like a surfer, you have to take the wave that comes. And so I have given no thought.
Like, I thought that Spike was a punk rocker before he was a vampire, which is like the most boring thing you could think in your life. So if I would have gotten my wish on that one, the character would be half of what it is now. So I'm very happy to be surprised about this stuff. Batman's already taken. Who's the short one? What's the short superhero? Ant-Man is taken. I would love to do that, but I don't know what I would do.
No, man, the Marvel's taking over.
Swamp Thing.
Swamp Thing, yes. I can see it. I can definitely see it.
Yeah. Don't sell DC TV short, though. There's a lot of great DC TV coming out with Greg Berlanti and his crew. I'm not trying to...
Definitely. It's a battle. DC and Marvel's a battle right now.
Why do you have to be in this one camp or the other? It's fine. Embrace it all. Image, right over here.
I was wondering if we could talk about the Bard. I was wondering what you think of the modern interpretations of Shakespeare.
Well, it really depends if they understand the play. Like, you can go to any playhouse, and you know, on the stage, there's often productions that you can tell they don't get it at all, you know. And then you go to one that's really good, like the Baz Luhrmann Romeo and Juliet with Leonardo DiCaprio. That's awesome. That was absolutely the perfect Romeo and Juliet, because actually Romeo and Juliet is not about love. It's about love being crushed. It's actually about the rape. It's like, metallurgists at one point, back up. Swords in the Middle Ages were basically clubs with kind of an edge, but they never really held. But they were basically, they would bludgeon each other. And as metallurgy grew, they got a finer and finer point, and swords started to thin out and become, and they could hold their blade, and they could hold their shape thinner and thinner and thinner until they came up with the rapier, which is basically a long needle. And once they invented that, then armor became obsolete, and you just didn't have any defense against this blade. And within a 3-year period, 30% of Europe died. It was just an apocalypse. And Shakespeare was right in the middle of it. And he wrote a play about society falling apart in the face of this weapon. And so Baz Luhrmann, he did update it, but he put it into a place, and he did it with a handgun. And he made very much the same point. And I thought that was actually a good update. In general, I don't think it's good to take those stories out of the time that Shakespeare put them in, because Shakespeare had a 600-year history to choose from, and his plays span all of that. So it's pretty good, you know. Like, he was pretty good. So keep them, you know. It's cool to put them where he put them. There's, you know, it's a large scope of history. But that's one. I think that there's a good Macbeth that's coming out. I haven't seen it, but the trailers look great, and they're keeping it in Scotland, which was, you know, there's just no parallel for Scotland at that time. Scotland had to become king in Scotland, you had to kill the king. You couldn't pass it down to your son. You had to go to battle and kill the king before you. So it was civil war constant. And in that backdrop, Macbeth deciding to kill the king before him is just a small little step over the line into evil, which is his point. But it's almost impossible to find a situation like that anywhere else in history where that would happen. So I always like keep Macbeth. Like, don't make gangsters. Like, does that answer your question?
I could bore everybody by going down this road, but you don't think that the whole idea that Shakespeare's plays, specifically his Big 20, the universal themes, you can't just pluck them out of the scenery. The scenery that he sets them in helps make it as good as you remember.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, like, you can't take, like, Ridley Scott's Alien, right? You couldn't just, like, they're going to Disneyland. And it's gonna work. You know, like, you have to, he made it that for a reason. It has a far-ranging implication for all the characters. You know,
plus the claustrophobia.
Well, everything, you know, like, it has to be, it's all one machine. And if you start to pick apart the machine, it just doesn't run as well.
So all you people running black box theaters, take note. Graphic over here.
Good evening.
Hello.
Referring back to your time in Smallville, specifically in season 5, there was that one episode which Clark explores a sorority house full of vampires. My question is, whose idea was it on the production team for you to deliver the line, Clark, there's no such thing as vampires?
Seriously. Like, I saw that script and I was like, oh, come on, guys. They know that I was a vampire recently. We don't have to remind them of that. But like, I'm not gonna second guess Al Goff. It was Al Goff. And basically, he's a genius. Al fixed Superman, as far as I'm concerned. Like, I always thought that Batman was a better dramatic character. I don't want to start a war in here. But if you shoot Batman, he's dead. So, it's easy to get him into an adventure. Oh no, they might shoot him in the head, you know? But if you shoot Superman in the head, it's like what? Okay. So, how do you get that character into an adventure if the audience knows that he's going to be just fine at the end? It's very hard without kryptonite every single time. And so when Al came to me and said, you know, I want you to come to the Superman show, I was like, Al, I don't know, I'm a Batman guy. And he's like, I know, I fixed it. I'll explain it to you, come to dinner. And he explained, he said, I'm going to make Superman so young that he's not yet a man. I'm going to make him, he's unaware of all of his power, so he doesn't really know that he's super yet. So he's going to be vulnerable to everything that a teenager is vulnerable to, which is basically everything. You know, his parents, his love life, his grades, his teachers, his self-identity, everything. And he'll be vulnerable all the time. And we don't need kryptonite. We'll use it sometimes, but not always. And I was just like, ah! He fixed it, you know, so I'm not going to second guess him, but I thought that was cheesy.
I'm wondering how you kept a straight face, I'm not going to lie.
How many takes?
I don't know, we only get two. You got to do it right. It's one of those things, like, get it over with, man, but don't drag it out, just get it out of the mouth and keep going.
Very professional, thank you.
You're welcome.
Welcome to Dallas. My question is for when you were working on Buffy, how long would it take to make an episode complete from when you received the script to shooting? Like, run us through what a typical day would be like for you then.
Yeah, it was an 8-day process, so it would be one 5-day week and then another 3 days. But the trick is, you don't know how long those days would be. So most television shows would shoot 12 hours and there's a hard stop at 12 hours. Because after 12 hours, you have to pay the crew time and a half. Then after a certain amount of hours, you have to pay them double, which is called golden time. And that becomes really expensive. So most television shows really cut it at 12. Buffy, 12 was the shortest day we ever had. It was usually 14, 16, 18, sometimes 20-hour days. Right, so we would start at 4:30 in the morning on Monday morning, and we would only get out when the sun came up Saturday morning, which we call it Friday night, but who's kidding us, you know? There were people that would not work for Buffy. Crew members, actors, directors, they would not come to work for the show because they knew we were called Buffy the Weekend Slayer. it was a hard slog, you know? It's like we only have 8 days, but they would film 10 to 11 days of filming within those 8 days. And then, if Joss was directing, he would cheat, and he would have B unit, Splinter unit, and secret CIA ops unit that the network doesn't know about, and hush, hush, hush. It was the worst. It was the most hilarious during the musical. Because I think that he took like 16 days or 18 days to film that. And we had the 8 that the network knew about. And then while we were filming, Tabula Rasa?
Rasa.
When we were filming that one, we were still filming the musical. So, and we couldn't tell, shh, come here. You know. So, yeah, we were cheating the whole time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
when you would get a copy of a Buffy script, would you look through to see, all right, no prosthetic, no prosthetic, no prosthetic?
No, I would read it in my head.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's a Joss Whedon show. Of course, you'd be honest with
me. I was always afraid that I was going to be killed off. Yeah, at all times. Yeah, because no one's saying. So everyone read it. Yeah. But we would get the scripts. We would get the scripts like the day before we started filming. And we would often just get a few scenes and then an outline because Joss was so particular about the writing, it was never quite good enough. So to get a full script before we started filming was not all the time.
And one of the things that I've become buddies with Jane Espenson, and one of the first questions I asked her, well, actually one before that, we ran a clip reel of some of the most famous episodes that she had lead writer credits on. And we ran the clip reel, brought her out on stage, and she comes out and she says, I didn't write one line of any of that dialogue. That was all Joss, every single thing we just showed. So
that was, yeah, that to be a writer on that show, what a mixed blessing. Because you're going to be known for your lifetime as being a genius. But, because this is what was happening. Joss was asking all of those writers, I mean, these are people like Steve DeKnight, who's doing Daredevil, David Fury, Big 24 and Lost. These are not slouch writers. These are awesome writers. Drew, the two Drews, so many. Anyway, they were being asked to come up with their worst day, the day that they never tell anyone about, the day that they're ashamed, the day that they hurt someone, that they had no good reason hurting someone, the day that they were embarrassed very, very badly, the day that keeps them up at night and no one else knows about it. And they were being asked to slap fangs on top of that pain and tell the world. Right? And then, and that's an act of bravery that I don't even know if I even have. And then Joss would take that script and say, very good idea, not good enough, not good enough, not good enough, not good enough. And he would take each scene and hand out scenes to pairs of writers. There were 9 or 10 of these writers. And he would pair them up and say, you take scene 1774 of these scenes, and he would mix it up, and then they would come back, and then he would polish after that. And so you have Jane, who like spills her heart out for you, and then he just takes everything else away, so you don't even have the pride of...
He doesn't just kill characters, he'll kill your favorite words, too.
No, and the most heartless thing about it is it's better. That is
right back over here.
All right, well, that's a good lead-in to my question. I just finished watching season 5 of Angel again. I was curious as to how much you and David were ever told from the beginning which one of you was the savior or not.
Do we even know now? I would say it's me. You'd have to ask Dave about his side of things. No clue.
I wasn't sure if they told you in advance, you know,
like,
this
seriously, is there an answer? Does that become a conclusion?
We don't even know if you're still alive.
Like, if we hadn't got canceled, I think that would have played out the whole time. I think that never would have been resolved.
Well, didn't they go into that in Angel Series 6 in the comics?
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, Angel Series 6 and 7, man. It's
cool. Who is it?
I don't know. I haven't read it yet. All right. Anybody just shout.
Yes? No?
No one.
Oh, come on!
No one.
That's what I mean. It's a big red herring. It's simply...
It was both. What a cheat!
It's a situation to set up conflict, basically. Yeah.
And wasn't that show the best when you two were sparring?
Oh, I love that.
I love most, like, okay, this is the thing. In Hollywood, no matter how nice the lead is, and David and Sarah are very nice people, but politically, you have to be so nice to them. You have to be, oh, may I get you a coffee, Sarah? Oh, David, take my seat, David. And I'm a subversive artist. I am like, if someone is big and powerful, I just, tear them down. So I loved playing a character that when they said action, I'm like, oh, and if you notice, like that's, and it's propelling me in those scenes, you can tell I'm really having fun and I'm really out for blood because I really am. And then I fell in love with Buffy, I was like, no! And I
coat, Buffy. And then I got on the Angel, and I was like, I'm back! Make life hell for me. Love that guy. Yeah.
Right back over here.
Hi, Mike. So, you're dropping the hard question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you regret Dragon Ball Evolution?
Just one. Okay, this is what I say. That movie was horrible. We all know that. I was told when I auditioned that this was a $130 million picture and Stephen Chow was producing it. Stephen Chow did Kung Fu Hustle and Shaolin Soccer, which if anyone has not seen those movies, go watch them. They're amazing. Yeah. Both on Netflix, you have no way out. They're scary, they're violent, they're goofy, they're funny, there's love in there, there's all the elements that Dragon Ball Z would need. And Dragon Ball Z helped me raise my son. Right? At 7 years old, he wanted to start watching Dragon Ball, and it said 13 plus on the little cover there. And I said, well, let's watch it together, we'll talk about it. And it started a lot of conversations about manhood. Which I think that Dragon Ball Z is a great template for manhood, which is like, Goku is a true man. It's like, he's goofy, he's peaceful, he's not a violent man. If you give him his choice, he's going to be out in the backyard chasing butterflies with his kids, basically. But if you attack his family, he's going to take care of you. Right? And he's not a blusterer, he's not trying to prove himself. And then you have Vegeta, who is the short little villain guy, and he is like a template for the overgrown boy in a man's body who is constantly causing chaos so he can prove his manhood against, and he's never a man. And I just thought that was genius. So I was so passionate when I got this role. And then I got out to the desert and I find out that it's a $30 million picture and Stephen Chow was only on paper to fool everyone out to go up to Durango, Mexico and sweat it out in the desert. So I tried. Sorry.
If it helps you, wear the best part.
What?
If it helps you, wear the best part.
Thank you. But like, my son. Okay, wait. I'm not even done with this. Okay. So like, I'm wanting it to be a hit. Like, you're fooling yourself. You can't admit that it's so bad when it's coming out. So I want it to be a hit because I want to go on to the next one. I want it to be better. And my son is really excited. He was at this point. I think he's like 12 when it came out, or something like that. And he's leading us through the Cineplex, and he's really excited to get us to watch his dad do Piccolo and everything. And he leads us into the theater, and I'm thinking, oh, come on, make it a half a house, just half a house. I want this to be a hit, please, please, please. We walk in, and it's packed. There's almost no seats left. It smells like hot dogs and body odor. and I'm like, this. And we sit down, and something in my mind goes, this is too good to be true. And I lean over to a 13-year-old next to me, and I go, hey, man, is this Dragon Ball? And he goes, what? And I go, is this Dragon Ball? And he goes, no, man, this is Fast and Furious. And so I had to take my two kids, my young kids, daddy's day, to be a cool dad, and lay them across the hall to Dragon Ball, and I'm just thinking, please, just maybe 25 people, Lord, please, just don't embarrass me. We walk in, including the three of us, there's five people over here. It's like the universe going, you need a little humility, buddy. So yeah, the last thing I'll say is the truest thing about Dragon Ball was the honest trailers said, Dragon Ball, the biggest offense against Japanese culture since Hiroshima. It's like the modern version of getting a Pauline Kael bad review.
Yeah,
getting the honest trailer.
You're guilty.
Yeah, there you go. Right over here.
Hi, I have a question about Ghost of the Robot, because I heard rumors that there's new music, and I was wondering if there's going to be a tour as well.
Yes, we just came back from a European tour this summer, where we were in Barcelona, Spain, and Rome, Italy, and Positano, and Marseille, France.
And then this summer, we're gonna do a West Coast tour. I was just talking to Charlie about this. We're gonna do a road tour. So we're just gonna get the bus, and we're gonna get the vans, and we're gonna get all of our equipment, and we're just gonna play, drive. Which I think is exciting, but I mean, get me in the middle of that tour, I'll be like, I don't think this is exciting anymore. So that's our touring schedule. We are a band that's always been hobbled for touring, because when we first got together, three of our members were in high school. So you can't quit high school. Or like the parents made me promise that I wasn't going to, you know, do that to my sons. And then, you know, many after high school it was college. And then finally, when everyone got out of college, we included another band member who was in high school. He's a genius, and he's like writing songs, and he lays in on everybody's stuff, and he's amazing, and now he's in college. So the only time we can really tour is the summertime. And we can hit a couple of dates in Christmas, you know, but we really have one window a year, and that's summertime. So we're gonna do a dog and pony show through the West Coast. So come join us. We're gonna be like from Southern California all the way to Seattle.
You're always welcome in Oklahoma. You have the internet.
Right on.
Get the guys out of college, do a Route 66.
Yeah!
It'll be amazing. Because you don't want to run around in the vans in the middle of the damn summer, is it? August?
Right over here.
Hola. Hi.
Hey, Evan.
Love
Sean's soccer, by the way.
Yes.
I wanted to know, between Angel and Buffy the Vampire Slayer, which did you enjoy the most? Which experience did you enjoy? And if you can share one of your most memorable scenes, that'd be awesome. And I'd love to know which female hero is your favorite?
Which what?
Female hero.
Oh, okay.
Between
okay.
DC
wow.
Whatever.
Okay. First of all. Buffy and Angel, from my perspective, was kind of the same show. I worked with David all the time over on Buffy, and I was doing scenes with David again. I'm like, well, this is normal. It was the same writers, the same producers, the same directors, a lot of the same actors. So that was kind of the same. What was the second part of this? Which was my favorite? My favorite. Okay, this is the most embarrassing thing. This is a good story. On Buffy, we were so proud of this $250,000 monster we were gonna have. I forget which season it was, but I remember Dawn was in the scene, so it must have been later on. And it was a big dragon. And for weeks everyone's talking about, can't wait for the dragon, it's gonna be so awesome. Because like we were always afraid we were gonna be cheesy. And we didn't have enough money for the big special effects because it's just television. And you don't have computers yet to bail you out. So we get into this scene, and they have like four puppeteers inside this huge dragon, and they're making it go. But in the scene, it's in the sewer, and they're dumping water on this foam dragon. And pretty soon the dragon starts going, and the director's like, what's wrong? Puppeteers, come on, get on the walkie-talkie, get on. And finally the head puppeteer is like, well, I think there's a problem. One moment. And he opens it, and out spill the four puppeteers, and they're sweating, and they can barely move. Because the thing is now like 4 to 5 times heavier than it was designed. And the dragon, they're off at the doctors, and the dragon is just laying there. And I think it was Jim Cotner was the director? I think it was, yeah. And we're just like, well, screwed. What are we going to do, Jim? He's like, I have no idea what we're going to do. And we don't have time to film this tomorrow. We have to find a way to get this dragon up and working with no puppeteers. And it was just like darkness, we're done. And I finally said, okay, this could be horrible, but just prop the dragon up on the big rock and just like put his head over there. And I will sit in front of the rock, and then I will take the arm of the dragon and kind of beat myself. As long as you frame it right, it'll be okay. It's not gonna be great, but because there's no puppeteers left, there's nobody to even like make the dragon do the right thing. I'm just like, I'll do it. And I still, I gotta go out and watch that episode, but I'm always so afraid it's horrible. I think when I saw it, I was like, yep, that's bad. That's really bad, but it's better than what it would have been. Yeah, Spike saves the day.
Ed Wood couldn't have come up with a better
response. Oh my gosh, so Ed Wood. It was such an Ed Wood day. Yeah, big time. God.
Yeah, I can hear.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Hi. Have you ever played any pranks on set?
No. No. I asked Joss, and I was like, Joss, why am I never in the gag reel? You know, everyone else at the end of the year, they've all got these funny moments, you know. But I'm never in it. Why? He's like, because you're boring. I said, James, whenever we say cut, you do this for years now. You do exactly the same thing every single shot. You check down and make sure you're on your mark, and you go back to your chair, pull out your sides, and make sure you got your lines right. And that's all you ever do. Now, when I call action, it's like releasing a small tire. But I mean, that's great. But then once I call cut, you got nothing. So I will tell you, Jared and Jensen played a good prank on me when I was at Supernatural. And they said I was warned that if they like you, they'll prank you, so watch out. And when I was doing my scene with them, we were on my close-up. And Jared and Jensen are doing their thing, blah, 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 blah. And I feel, how many kids are in the audience?
Earmuffs.
I can do this without going there. And I feel some bobbling in the nether. Some light bobbling. And I look down, and Jared's got his shoes off. And he's like, can you get your close up now, Master Actor Thespian Man? And I just kind of glanced down and I just continued the take. Now the director is only watching the monitor, so he doesn't know what's going on. And we finished the cut, and we finished the shot, and he's like, okay, cut, that was great, move on. And the Jared Jensen just went, oh, dude.
This might be an opportune moment to bring up a good friend of ours here at Dallas Comic Con, one John Barrowman. Anytime John Barrowman shows up here at Dallas Comic Con, I will get texted about 200 to 250 times I have been touched inappropriately by John Barrowman, and it's awesome. So, yeah. You have also had a similar experience, if my research is correct.
Yeah. John is one of my favorite people in the world. He's got a heart of gold. He is surprisingly wholesome for how naughty he is. It's the weirdest thing, you know? But it takes a while for you to figure out that he's really got no... He's not. To figure him out, it takes a little while. When I first got on the set of the show, Torchwood. I am uncomfortable with sex scenes and lovemaking scenes. It's just such an intimate thing to have 50 grips going. Yeah. It's just, I don't like it. I did enough of it on Buffy, and I just have a thing about it now. And I also no means no is important, especially, you know, and like if a lead can get away with too much, and you know, like if you're the lead, you're not fireable, so if you want to be a jerk about this, you can really get away with a lot. And so I was going to have this kissing scene, and I was just like, okay, I hope he's cool. I hope he's cool, because I'm going to clock him if he's not cool. And so I had my dander up first day, and I go on the set, and we're not filming that scene first. We're with the whole Scooby gang, the whole Torchwood gang. And John is just being John. He's like grabbing the girls, you know. And Miyoko was just going, come on, John, not now. I don't want to, not now. And this happened a couple of times, and I was like, oh no. all right, here we go. And I'm like, hey, Nyoko. She's like, what? I'm like, hey, babe, sneeze. When he comes up behind you like that, just sneeze. She's like, what? I'm like, yeah, sneeze. Achoo, bam, it'll break his nose. Get his attention right away. Or, there's a lot of little bones up on the top of the foot, man. Just take your heel, which is a big bone, and just stamp right on those little bones, man. Just break two or three of them like that. Or, big, nice bone into here. So if you go in the solar plexus and they're in the back of you like that, you've really come to no harm and you can get them really good. And whole cats turn around like, who is this maniac we're having to shoot with? We're all friends here. Phew. And I quickly learned that they were all comfortable with each other. It was all good. And John is a wonderful person. I did see his junk one day. It got boring. He warned me. If it gets really boring and I get tired, I'm just going to drop it. Just so that he, because he knew. See, John knows that you're supposed to have fun. Like, he comes from stage. I come from stage. There's a saying that says it's called play for a reason. No one's going to pay money to watch you work. Right? And television looks great on the screen, but it's actually fairly brutal to actually make. People are throwing rocks at you, or you're uncomfortable, or you're freezing, or you're hot and sweating, and you can not have fun pretty easily. And John will not allow that to happen. So if things are getting kind of heavy, he's just like, hi guys, boom. What's going on? And suddenly it's really interesting, like, okay, here we go. And that sense of fun you can see on the screen, I think he's a genius that way. And when I finally caught on, you know, like there's a picture of him licking me. That's day three. I finally understood, like, okay, I get you. But I remember we were filming, I think this is the second episode I was in, we were out on a cow pasture, and it was 4 o'clock in the morning, the sun was rising, crew was setting up. It is horrible that the crew is hating life. Everyone is misty, everyone's been raining, we're freezing, and it's just miserable out there. And John and I are going insane. Because we're gonna have fun, right? And we're like jumping around, we're chasing each other, and there's this young actor fresh out of acting school that's playing his brother, and he's just sitting in a chair going. And I sit down next to him, I go, dude, man, I bet when you're done with this show, you're going straight back to theater and you are never coming back. And he goes, how did you know? And I had to explain to him about the whole fun thing. It's easier to have fun in theater because it's a controlled environment. It's always at the same time. It's 8 o'clock. It's indoors. You know, it's easier. All right.
And no one's splashing their junk at you.
Exactly. Well, no, that's not true.
Especially if you're doing Equus.
Right around here.
Hello.
Mm-hmm.
In season 5 and 6 of Buffy, the fans got to see a whole lot of you. Did you have a personal trainer or workout regimen you liked, or how did you prepare to have so much exposure?
I remember going to just Joss. When was Riley? Was season 4?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So after the Riley season, I went up to Joss and I was like, you know, Joss, if you ever want me to go shirtless, can you just give me some damn warning? Because if you warn me, I can work out and I can give you what you need. But if you don't warn me, you're gonna get another Riley here. Because I look good in a t-shirt, but if you want to take that off, you know, some work has to happen. And I'm like, oh, good. Well, prepare. You have the summer because you and Buffy, you're going to fall in love with Buffy. And I was like, oh, that's awesome. Like, of course, like, I fall in love with her, but of course she doesn't reciprocate because that would be stupid, right? And he's like, no, you guys are going to have sex. And I was like, okay. Because I thought it would be hilarious if Spike falls for Buffy, and he never reciprocates, but he's constantly trying to be the man that she wants, and then failing to hilarious effect. I thought that would be great, but that was more interesting. I worked out like a maniac over the summer, and then starved myself during the shoot so that I had a low body weight. low fat ratio. And it was a lot of not chewing. Which sucks.
Genocide of chickens. You have the last question, make it a good one.
What?
Yeah, really?
Really?
Pressure.
Okay, alright.
I'm sorry, I didn't do my good job.
You're mean.
I know.
You're
mean
that.
So this is from an episode of Angel, and I introduced this topic to a group of friends of mine, and it's become a pretty heated debate since among us. And I just want to know what you honestly think. Who would win in a fight, a caveman or an astronaut?
Oh, of course, it's no, it's the caveman would win.
Oh, no.
Yes, because look, you have the astronauts are very small people. They have to fit inside the capsule. So it's not like they've got big NBA stars up there. It's little tiny short people are in there. So it's going to be the caveman every time.
Unless the astronaut is Matt Damon.
You met Matt Damon's short friend.
Well, James Marsters, ladies and gentlemen.
Love you guys. I'll see you this weekend.
We got a great weekend planned for you guys. Hope you guys have as much fun as we do up here. We'll see you in a little bit.